A PDF of additional material accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Party of the People, Inside the Multiracial Populist Coalition Remaking the GOP, by Patrick Ruffini. Read by Stephen Graybill. To Maggie. Foreword. Culturally, you would not peg me as an enthusiast for populist realignment. I grew up in Greenwich, Connecticut, the hometown of George H.W. Bush, and a place synonymous with the East Coast Republican establishment. Most of my early career in politics was spent working for his son, the 43rd president, who today has come to represent everything the Republican Party, my party, is not. In the spring of 2015, though, the turn the party would take wasn't yet clear. Republicans were out of power for 8 years, and it seemed like their turn to win the next election in 2016. This expectation drew a historically large field of 16 candidates. Then, Donald Trump joined the race. At first, I was amused. Then, watching Trump surge ahead in the polls, I was horrified. Trump's boorishness and profanity seemed likely to hand the election to Hillary Clinton on a silver platter. Following Trump's initial primary victories, some Republican friends and I went all in on a last-ditch super PAC to stop Trump, pushing strategic voting either for Ted Cruz or John Kasich. Neither was my cup of tea, but at this point it had to be anyone but Trump. We had successes here and there, for instance, helping in Trump's defeat in the Wisconsin primary. But if I'm being honest, even then I recognized it was too little too late. After Trump's victory in the primaries, a feeling of dejection set in. The party had just blown the election before it had even started. We shuttered the pack and sent the remaining funds to a set of non-Trumpy Republicans we hoped would be left to hold the line against a now inevitable Clinton presidency. My objections to Trump were about more than one election. He threatened to do lasting damage to the ability to advance important conservative causes, needlessly antagonizing Hispanic voters, the fastest-growing group within the electorate, and a group Republicans desperately needed to win in the America of the future. I turned out to be wrong about the 2016 election. A lot of us were, and so I committed to spend the next few years listening and learning. This book is the result of that effort. I work as a pollster. Understanding where the voters stand is my job. And like others in the field, I had egg on my face after 2016. It's not that I completely discounted the probability of a Trump victory. I put the chances at 20% the weekend before the election. My polling had shown that even if he didn't win, the swing voter still gravitated toward his cultural views on issues like immigration, in retrospect, a harbinger of hidden support. Yet throughout most of the election cycle, a Trump victory seemed unthinkable to me. My mistake was in substituting my own personal passions and biases, as the quintessential suburban college-educated voter, for a neutral, clear-eyed assessment of who the actual demographic majority in America was and where they stood. Trumpism has certainly had its costs, coarsening the public debate, damaging the Republican brand in the suburbs, and driving decent and respectable Republicans from public service. These exiles are often called the normal Republicans, itself a sign that we are still in denial. Yes, Trump's behavior in office was highly abnormal. But by any definition, the almost 90% of Republicans who supported the president of their own party were the ones acting normally, not the few holdouts like me wildly overrepresented inside the Beltway. Trump not only won the 2016 election when I predicted he wouldn't, he had done so in a way that not even our heroes, Ronald Reagan and both Bushes, could manage, running up historic margins among working-class voters and undermining the Democrats' historic claim to be the party of the working man and woman. We were not as surprised by the outcome of the 2020 election. Joe Biden won an election he was widely expected to, but the margin was much closer than anticipated. And the reason we came within a hair of a second Trump term was an unexpected surge of non-white voters, particularly Hispanic voters, his way. Suddenly, the new Republican populist coalition was a multiracial one. This was not at all what I had expected in 2016 when I fretted about Trump throwing away the Hispanic vote for a generation. The level-headed, majority-building realist in me had very mixed feelings about all this. I won't recite all that I find distasteful about Donald Trump. The reasons have been endlessly recounted for 8 years everywhere else, not least in the private conversations of Republican elected officials. But Trump was also accomplishing a goal I had dedicated a big part of my career to, one that the normal Republicans had failed to achieve, rallying working-class people and minorities in a political coalition that punched above its weight in the fight for 270 electoral votes. Reflecting on the 2016 experience, I began to realize that my background and life experiences themselves were the problem. They had blinded me to an accurate understanding of the American electorate, especially the Republican electorate, and most especially the new Republican electorate. I only saw the swing voters that might be repulsed by Trump, not those drawn to him. And it was all because of a fatal reality-blinding flaw I shared with almost everyone in politics and the media. I graduated from college. Education was the key dividing line in 2016. Especially among white voters, the non-college majority trended toward Trump, and the college-educated minority trended toward Clinton or third-party candidates. And if we were being honest, myself and those in my peer group were unable to see objectively what was happening, because the trend was happening to us. Virtually no one in our group possessed the demographic characteristics that would let them see the appeal of Trump's blunt-talking style. A college diploma, the most basic prerequisite for working at high levels in politics and the news media, was the very thing that blinded the elite to Trump's appeal and hobbled those who wished to stop him. This blind spot was not only an affliction of the liberal beltway media. A certain squishiness on cultural issues undergirded the entire Republican establishment. For us, fire-breathing cultural rhetoric was a necessary but unpleasant price to pay for the ultimate objective: electing candidates who would supercharge the economy through faster growth, less regulation, and lower taxes. This version of the official Republican Party, highly educated, higher income, metropolitan, above all concerned with questions of strategy and electability, is now widely recognized as being on its last legs. But what is less well understood is that this was never the party's true identity to begin with. The establishment was only able to exert the control that it did thanks to a like-minded set of candidates and the weakness of the populist alternatives up to that point. In a country where a majority had not graduated from college, in a party where more and more of the voters did not graduate, ruled by a consultant class that did not look like its voters was someday bound to collapse. In the wake of this collapse, it would be easy to issue a jaded call for elites to understand the real America, with reporting trips to diners in West Virginia and such. But the challenge is in many ways more profound. It is not merely one of considering the views of voters outside the Beltway, but of nullifying a set of beliefs indigenous to college-educated professionals who live and breathe politics in both parties. And what are these beliefs? They boil down to being further to the left on social and cultural issues than the members of our respective parties are. This is not a problem specific to political professionals, but is a condition common to most college graduates. For Democratic elites, It's the recent fashion for identity politics, including the use of terms like Latinx that Hispanics themselves almost never use. And for Republican elites, it's a distaste for conservative cultural stances that leads them to run instead on a limited government economic philosophy that the average voter doesn't understand. When it comes to winning elections, the distinctive worldview of the college graduate often gets in the way. It was the surprising outcome of the 2020 election that finally pushed me to write this book. Trump's 2016 victory had been framed by liberals in terms of white racial resentment, thanks to his victories among working-class whites. This was never the full story. Many of these same Trump-shifting voters had also shifted toward Barack Obama, making him the first black president. Now, in 2020, the phenomenon known as education polarization, pushing non-graduates right, was expanded to include Hispanic, Asian American, and even black voters, the most loyal Democratic group. If this trend continues, it would mean the birth of a new party system, replacing the old 20th century class divide between the parties, Democrats for the poor and the workers, Republicans for the rich and the professional classes. If this happened, it would signal that race-specific factors that bound non-whites to the Democratic Party no longer matter as much, a sign of fading racial divides in society at large. With traditional Democratic constituencies voting Republican at higher rates, Democrats would no longer be able to claim the moral high ground as the tribune of workers and marginalized minority groups. The rejection of the left-wing politics of social change by formerly impoverished or discriminated against groups would also be a sign of their improving lot, a testament to the success of the American experiment. Accounts of populist realignment often carry dark undertones, but the story told in these pages is a hopeful one. It is one of strivers rising through the ranks of American society through their own hard work, not looking for a government handout or no longer voting for the party of economic redistribution. The trends that in 2016 seemed to usher in a period of unparalleled racial animosity are, after 2020, pointing the way toward less racially polarized voting and a less racially polarized society. Heading into the 2020 election, signs that this might happen were as yet tentative. I explored this possibility in a 2019 paper for the Bipartisan States of Change Project, which would become the nucleus of this book. If a multiracial realignment happened, I concluded, it would not happen as a repudiation of populism or Trumpism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.